Thank you for the nice introduction. We are going to present to you the very first work we have done together about the possibilities of particle classification through a miniature sensor. First of all, I will quickly present to you the problem of pollution by fine particles. Fine particles are also called particulate matter. PM is made up of solid or liquid particles that are in the air. These particles may include dust, dirt, soot, smoke, bacteria, pollen, smoke, etc. Particulate matter and harmful health. What we know? In France and from most countries, PM10 and PM2.5 particles are the only ones regulated for their effects on health according to their size. PM10 are particles with a diameter less than 10 micrometers and PM2.5 are particles with a diameter less than 2.5 micrometers. Largest particles are retained in the nose and upper airways. PM2.5, because of their fineness, are able to penetrate deep into the respiratory system to the pulmonary alveoli. When fine particles enter the lung alveoli, they can enter the bloodstream and cause serious problems, including heart attacks, coronary artery disease, heart rhythm disorders, and stroke. What is done? In France, to date, PM10 and PM2.5 particles are the only ones regulated for their effects on health according to their size. What we don't know? There is no distinction of danger according to the nature of the particles PM10 and PM2.5 because of the absence of portable sensor allowing to count them by differentiating them. Hence, Mönchhofer is directed towards developing portable sensor of improved detection and discrimination of different types of aerosols. Why we don't know? Particle classification is only done by reference instruments. They are very expensive and especially non-transportable. That's why we don't have data about the correlation between the kind of particles and the harmful health. What is needed? To establish the harmfulness of particles, we need a miniature particle sensor capable of discriminating particles according to their nature in addition to their size. What we done for the first steps? We studied optical information obtained by a miniature sensor to evaluate the possibility to do more than size characterization. Sensor used in this study is an XPM, manufactured by TerraSensor. Now I'm going to present briefly the company TerraSensor. The company TerraSensor belongs to the Terra Group. Terra Group is a French group specializing in the measurement and analysis of air quality in real time. The group has three types of activity. A service activity dedicated, for example, to the analysis of chemical air pollutants for all environments, indoor, outdoor, and controlled, as in microelectronics. This activity is completed by the rental of microstation intended to measure in real time the presence of certain pollutants. We have done a cell activity in OEM to integrators of innovative sensor made in France for real-time measurement of air quality. And then a digital activity dedicated to data accessibility and data processing. TerraSensor designs, develops, and commercializes advanced solutions and breakthrough technology for air quality monitoring. It is positioned as an OEM manufacturer. The company mainly develops technological bricks. TerraSensor is specialized in the development of real-time miniature sensors for air quality measurement. Its sensors are designed to be integrated into finished products such as measuring stations or citizen sensors. With its expertise, TerraSensor supports its partners around the world in the development of their own products. Its partners include manufacturers in the microelectronics, transport and building sectors, and local authorities. It could concern sensors for many applications such as clean room, smart office, health, of appliance, etc. In this slide, you can see a specific development for a UIA project called PIAMS. PIAMS-CAN is a citizen sensor, including NEXPM technology commercialized by TerraSensor. It is this technology which is studied in detail. Now, I'm going to talk about the optical specificities of technology NEXPM. Before explaining how the NEXPM sensor works, I'm going to summarize the optical principles that we use. When a particle is illuminated by a laser beam, it will scatter the light received in different directions. For a given particle size and a given wavelength, the scattering patterns of the particle will be governed by specific physical laws. As an example, for a particle with a diameter ranging from 0.3 microns to 10 microns, and for a wavelength about 650 nanometers, the scattering pattern of the particle is described by the Mead theory. More precisely, the scattering pattern also depends on the shape and the nature of the particle. Our NEXPM module is a miniature sensor measuring in real time particle matter PM1, PM2.5, and PM10. It has been specially designed to bring a professional miniature solution to the air quality market. The NEXPM sensor is based on laser light scattering. A single particle enters the fluid path. The fluidic path has been developed to allow the passage of particles one by one while rejecting particles with a diameter greater than 10 microns. Particles are led through this path and enter in chamber where it illuminated by a laser beam. The interaction of the laser light and the particle generates light scattering in space, depending on size, shapes, and nature. The information of scattering is captured by two photodetectors, here and here. This information is then processed by a specific algorithm to classify each particle according to its size. In this section, we want to answer to the following question: Do optical signals contain additional information? The objective of this pre-study is to quantify the information provided by the scattering of laser light by the particle from the NEXPM sensor. The question is to know if it's possible to distinguish some types of particles, among others, by the complex analysis of the signal obtained by the two photodiodes. The figure shows here an example of sound particle peak detection for part of an entire measurement file. In order to determine if it's possible to extract additional information from the peak detection measurements of the NixPM sensor, it was decided to study in more detail the signal obtained by the photodiodes 1 and 2. The development of a specific algorithm was carried out to select the useful signals in the whole of the measurements carried out in order to associate with the passage of a particle its two peaks of detection resulting from the photodiode 1 and 2. It was decided that a particle detection should verify the following condition. The signal from photodiode 1 exceeds threshold 1 for at least 30 microseconds. The signal from photodiode 2 exceeds threshold 2 for at least 30 microseconds. And the maximum intensity of the photodiode 2 must be contained in the time bars of the detection peak of the photodiode 1 and vice versa, as you can see. Several measurement campaigns have been carried out in TerraSensor laboratory. In the first study, we compared several types of particles: table sugar, Arizona sand, polystyrene particles, acid citric, and salt. The temporal resolution chosen for this preliminary study is 10 microseconds. A second campaign concerns only table sugar, Arizona sand, and polystyrene particles, and the temporal resolution was reduced to 1 microsecond. Now, I give the floor to Anthony, data scientist researcher, who is going to talk about our first results.
Thank you. So, after this theory on the light and campaigns, what we have done is to work on the data that we have of both campaigns. And the first question, as you all saw during this week, because there was some data science courses, is to say, okay, what do we work on the raw signal as Emily showed before, or do we try to extract some features that are interesting? Problem of raw signal is that it can be a little noisy and can contain false detection. And when we process the data to extract some features, what we will improve also is that we will have more reproducible data. So we have gone through feature selection, feature extraction, and then feature selection using the prior knowledge that Emily has on the data. So next one, please. So for the feature selection, you have the complete signal with the photodiode signal. What we can extract, we can have descriptors that are in the time domain. For example, the maximum of the data during the acquisition, the area, time base, the ratio, etc. We can have frequency domain, for example, fast Fourier transform, DFT, etc. Roll-off, and what is not put here, but that we have also time frequency domain with wavelet transform, etc., etc. So we extracted all this information because it's after when we do some classification part, we have things that are more restricted for each class and more separated between the classes. Next one, please. First, what we would like is that this feature can be calculated in the detection system. So for that, we have to work on the relevance of the different features. Why? Because first, it's always a good choice to reduce the number of data because you eliminate some noise, you have a less number of dimension, etc., etc. But also for the device conception point of view, it's less costly to have a reduced number of data to extract. We have the more data we have to extract, the more computation power we have to have. And it improves also the validation of the system. It's simpler to validate the extraction of 10 data than 30 data, for example. Next one, please. So to reduce the number of features, first, we try to see the features that are more correlated between them. And we can see that we have a lot of correlation between some features that are close, but not in the same domain, for example, with Hilbert and DCT, etc. So all of this, it can show us that some of these features that are really correlated between them can be removed. We can remove one of both, etc. Between all these features, what I didn't say is that we have on this signal, on each photodiode signal, we have the maximum, the best time, cumulative sums, autocorrelation, maximum and minimum of autocorrelation, maximum of and minimum of DCT, of FFT, of wavelet, of EMF, the root mean square, the signal attack and growth, etc. And for signal one and signal two, we will do correlation between them. On distance between them, convolution, etc., etc. So, with this first selection, we can see that we have a lot of dimensions that are really correlated between them. So we can remove some of them and have less computation to do. Next one, please. Second thing that we have done on feature selection is to study the relevance of each attribute using classification and scoring with some classification algorithms. So for example, decision tree, KNN, Fisher, XGBoost, and regressor. You have here decision tree classifier and regressor. It's a little different. What we can see and what is interesting also here is that we can see that there is not one feature that solves everything, and there is not correspondence between these different classifiers. Each classifier will work on different part of the signal and on different theory. For example, decision tree will work more on okay. KNN will work on distance, and decision tree will work on statistics. So it's a different way to process the data. And we can see that, for example, we will not have for both the same features that will be relevant. So it's the first information that we have here, saying that we will have to investigate more on why some of the algorithm will respond more to one or more characteristics than the other. Next one, please. After, we will present you some first results on classification. So if you have here some insight on the particle distribution, and that you take a maximum of signal one, DCT of signal one and signal two as a mean, you can see some different distributions that are really coherent. As we don't have access to this information in real conditions, we will have to check with classifications that we can achieve some such result. Next one, please. So the first classification that we tried is on the, so as you remember, perhaps there is two campaigns of measurement. The first one with polystyrene sand, three different polystyrene sand, citric acid, salt, and sugar, as a temporal resolution of 10 microseconds. On this one, we tried different classifiers that you can see here, multilayer perceptron, k-nearest neighborhood, decision tree, SVC is a support vector, AdaBoost, etc., etc. And for each classifier, we tested with bootstrapping to select some feature attributes. The best accuracy was obtained with the following parameters: multilayer perceptron with 8 layers, ReLU activation, and a test on the five-fold cross-validation. With 9 attributes that are presented here on FFT, on EMF, convolution, time base, RMS, growth, etc., etc. And what we can see here for this first result is that it's complicated. As you can see, there is a lot of misclassification on the B part, B1, B2, B3. There is class A that is not recognized at all, etc., etc. So for this first result, it's interesting because we can see that here with this resolution, this parameter, this acquisition, processing B1, B2, B3 differently, etc., etc. We have too much confusion, but the results are encouraging. Next one, please. In the second condition, so as you remember, on the second campaign, it was only one, it was a temporal resolution on 1 microsecond, and it was only one polystyrene, salt, and
Sent.
sand. Thank you. I forgot sand before. Salt and sand. And on this one, we have worked on a cluster on a computing cluster with more than 1,000 cores. To test a lot of different classifiers, we tested almost 50,000 classifiers with different parameters on grid search algorithm, oversampling, downsampling, etc. And here we can see that the F1 score that is presented here is a little better. It's almost at 0.7. And the predicted class here are almost perfect on this little data set. So what we can see here is that we have changed two things, the temporal resolution and the number of class acquisition, etc. So we have to work further on all of this to be in every condition on the such result for classification. Next one, please. Another thing, it's you.
We have some relevant information, but optical information is not sufficient to have a good discrimination. So to do that, we must have new optical information identification. You must design new optical system. You must develop a test bench allocated to do this job. And then we want to develop a miniature prototype to identificated some class of particles. So further work on classification algorithm and pattern recognition for better performance will be done in next step. That's all.